All right, well, this morning we are going to be in John 17, and in John 17, we have a unique chapter in the book of John. It is entirely a prayer from Jesus Christ, and it's a very revealing prayer. He prays in this prayer first for himself, then for his disciples who are in the quick of the storm as he approaches his crucifixion and the hour where he will be glorified. And then he prays for believers to come. That would be us. And it's very revealing as Jesus begins to, in his heart, show us what matters most to him, what he spends his time on, what he focuses in his prayer as he prays over us. So to me, it's a very encouraging scripture to know that Jesus prayed then for me and continues to pray today for me in his role as a high priest. So I pray that it's going to be an encouragement to you as we hear Jesus pray for us this morning. So before we get in there, let's approach the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you at this time because we want to hear your heart. We're inviting your Spirit to work in our hearts in a powerful way. You know, every day, Father, is an opportunity for you to speak life and truth to us, to encourage us and strengthen us when we need it, to correct us and to convict us when we are in need of that. And Father, this morning, I just know that this family is so precious in your sight. These people mean a lot to you, Father. You have called them by name. You've built this place, and it's all about glorifying Jesus. It's all about finding our place in your family and coming alongside your mission, and we're taking this journey together. And Father, sometimes we celebrate together, sometimes we mourn together, sometimes we struggle together, but one thing always remains faithful. Father, you just continue to stay out in front and take us on this journey. So God, as we are a mixed group here this morning, all coming in from a variety of different experiences throughout the week and year, you know our hearts. You know what needs to be said. You see the hearts of men and women. And I invite you, Father, to use your Holy Spirit to accomplish what needs to be done in our hearts and lives today. God, we love you and we depend on your truth and the activity of your Spirit in our midst. Thank you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. John 17, known as the High Priestly Prayer. I want you, as we read through the prayer of Jesus, to pay attention to what concerns him the most for his followers. Now, John doesn't say it outright, but we're in the Garden of Gethsemane. We know this because Jesus has already had the Last Supper. He's taken a stroll with his disciples to this place. He has poured his heart out to them. He knows this is his last opportunity to talk to them before he's betrayed and drug away and led to the crucifixion and the trials. And so he has spoken his heart to his disciples over the last few weeks. We've followed that journey. And now this morning, he is going to pray over top of that. Lord, let these things be so. So you're going to hear some overlap. But I want you to understand that when we hear the prayer in Gethsemane from Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it has a different flavor. You know, we hear the words, you know, Father, let this cup pass from me. If there's another way, let's take that route. You know, we just see Jesus struggling and the sweat like blood dropping from his head. And the synoptic gospels, which just means the similar gospels, kind of record that prayer with that twist. But I want to remind you how much Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, because he led the disciples there. And remember, he went and prayed for an extended period of time. He came back and he kind of scolded the disciples. This, I'm in my hour, guys. My whole ministry has been about this. And you have fallen asleep. Can't you pray with me 1 hour? So then he goes back and he does it again, and he comes back to the disciples. They've fallen asleep, and he says, guys, can't you pray with me just 1 hour? And then he does it again. So we know at least 3 hours Jesus spends praying in the garden. So we're getting snippets. We're getting just pieces of that prayer. And the Holy Spirit wants to reveal to us in the book of John the portion of Jesus' prayer where he prays for us. And I want you to say it in such a way that he prays for me. He understood. He looked down through the tunnel of time and understood the hearts of men and women and what they would need. And he knew his followers were going to be need to pray for in this way. So just a powerful prayer recorded here in John 17. So let's jump in. We have a lot to cover. Verse 1, when Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. So as Jesus is coming into this, he begins his prayer and he's about to pray for himself. He wants God to glorify him in such a way that he will bring honor to the Father. That's what Jesus' ministry has been about from day one. As he is submitting to the Father, he is obeying the Father, he was sent by the Father, he wants to glorify the Father not only in his ministry and his life, but in his death. And he is setting the example for us Christians. Each day is a gift from God. And it should be our prayer and desire that that is a day that brings glory to God. We only get to live it once. We only get that shot one time. Jesus, now approaching his death, prays that in his death God would be glorified. And we are reminded that all around the world there are Christians making that commitment with their lives, that in their deaths they would honor God. No matter what circumstances we are in, our objective is to bring glory to God. Now, we're going to learn a lot about Jesus in these first five verses as he prays for himself. Verse 2, since you have given him authority over all flesh to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. All right, there's a couple things I want to touch on, and the first one is speaking of authority. Now, I had to introduce the first service to a special ministry within our church. It's a ministry called the Senior Deacons. The Senior Deacons are very close to me because part of their role is to advise and give spiritual counsel to the pastor, which I have leaned on and rely on heavily. And as I've gotten to know them over a period of time, 4 years that I've been here, I have been able to kind of find what's their passion in each of their hearts. So I found all three of their passions in this prayer of Jesus, which is probably a good sign. So I'm going to point those out. So the first one, this idea of authority, the lordship of Jesus Christ. If you know Dan Wickander, I think he's in here somewhere. There he is. He's smiling and cringing. Dan Wickander, you talk to him a little bit, and you're going to get to know that he is passionate about the lordship of Jesus Christ. Well, what does that even mean, the lordship of Christ? When we talk about being saved, when we talk about coming into the kingdom of God, we often will focus on, in that salvation, Jesus is our Redeemer, he's our Savior. He takes all of our sin and places it upon on himself, and takes his righteousness, places it on us. It's a glorious thing that we celebrate. Our eternal destiny is changed from separation. That's the word I'm going for. Second service, you're in for a ride. Without God versus eternity with God. All that changes in that moment. But he's more than just a Savior. It's not just our eternity that changes. It's our day-to-day living. And this is where the lordship comes in. This is where we see in the Garden of Gethsemane in the Synoptic Gospels, God, not my will, but yours be done. Not the desires of my flesh, but yours be done. And when the two cross paths, may your will be done. Now that's what lordship looks like. It is the understanding that when we came to Christ, we were bought with that price. We have given ourselves away. We have no say-so over our lives. We literally belong to him. That mentality is critical for a Christian's growth and development. Otherwise, we just begin to lean on Jesus for his benefits. And while there are many benefits to walking with Christ, we don't come to him as part of a sales agreement, as though, you know, if I come into this, looks like Jesus can do me a lot of favors. It's a deal. I'm going to do it. No, it is the slaying of our agenda, our lives, our dreams, and it is laying all that down and saying, God, everything that you want to accomplish in this life, it can be done through me, and I will cooperate with that, whether it's something that I desire or not. Your will be done in my life. All right, that is the way that the call is supposed to be understood. Not a cheap believism, but a laying down of our lives to live for God. And Jesus has over and over in Scripture all authority to do it. When we come to him, we come to a king who is at the top of the command when it comes to authority. Therefore, whatever he says goes. It is the lordship of Jesus Christ. We also see in verse 2 a mention of a Christian's election. He gives eternal life to all whom you have given him. Jesus receives from God the Father all that he has already chosen. And now this doctrine is called election, where God chooses who will be saved. And there's lots of scriptures in there, Ephesians 2:8, for by grace we are saved through faith, and that faith is not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. We have John 6:44, where we learn that no one comes to the Father unless he draws them first. We have Ephesians 1:4 that talks about God choosing us before the foundation of the world was laid. God's choice is what election teaches. However, you say, well, what about free will? Because you're always up there preaching about free will, John. And I would say this, free will is absolutely taught in the Bible. John 3:16 talks about whoever will respond to the offer that God has made through his Son. We have Romans 10:13, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. We have the receiving of Christ in Colossians 2:6. Therefore, as you have received Christ, so walk in him. Receiving him through John 1:12, as many as received Christ, he gave them the right to be called children of God, even to those who believed on his name. There is overwhelming scriptures to demonstrate that it is a choice. So how does all that work together? Well, let me tell you how I understand it. Coming into that decision, I understood that God was calling me to be a part of his kingdom. And I had a choice in front of me to follow him or not. And as a young man, I made that choice that I wanted to do that. So of my own free will, I was all in. I wanted what God wanted in my life. I wanted Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. Now, as I look back, I have a different perspective because I understand before I ever chose to follow God as a young boy, God had already chosen me all the way back at the foundation of the world. And God drew me with his Spirit, so God chose me also. And I take great comfort in knowing that God chose me. I don't know why he chose me. I'm sure glad he did. So then we say, well, how does all that work together? Well, my brain is not nearly large enough to explain that to you. There are some things that I just understand. They work together, whether I understand them or not. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret thing belongs to the Lord our God. Those things that are written belong to us and our children forever and ever. So there's some things where God just says, hey, listen, I'm not going to explain it all. Here's what you need to understand is my will and your will. They just run together like a rope of two cords. All right, they're not in contradiction to each other. They work in harmony with one another. And when we get into all the semantics, I'm not going to be able to play it all out for you. I just know that I'm grateful that I chose God, and I'm so grateful that he chose me. And that is clearly taught here in this introductory prayer of Jesus. Let's continue to move through verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Understand this, salvation is relational. When Jesus says, this is eternal life, that they may know you in Jesus Christ whom he has sent. He's talking about the kind of know where you know them as a friend. You know them intimately. You know you have a relationship there. You don't know of them. You know them. And everything about our salvation, our standing before God, is relational. From the very beginning, before we even enter into a positive relationship with God, we are in a negative relationship with God. John 3:36 says, whoever has a son has life. Whoever doesn't have the son does not have life. But God's wrath remains on him. God's angry. That's a bad place to start out, but it's where we start out. And it's just because we rebel against him. Almighty, holy, infinite God who gives us the breath in our lungs, and we have the audacity, even though he has given us a conscience and a choice, we go against what we know is right, and it offends him, and his wrath is stored up in heaven against us. It's relational. Whether it's positive or negative, it's relational with God. And he says, this is eternal life, that they may know you, that they may know Jesus Christ. When we come into this relationship, God literally brings us into his family. He calls us his children. He invites us to call him his father. It's extremely relational with God. His love is extremely deep for his children, but it has to be dealt with in a relational way. And those who know Jesus Christ have eternal life. Jesus just defines it that way. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Outside of that, there is not eternal life. And that does not make God unloving. It makes him supremely loving that he fixed the situation where his wrath was being stored up against our sin. He made a route, an avenue of rescue so that his wrath could be satisfied, and that was through Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, took the wrath of God for us. I don't think we'll ever really understand what kind of pill he took right there until we enter into eternity. What does it mean that the wrath of God fell on Jesus? I mean, we're talking more than nails going into hands at this point. What does it mean that God looked at Jesus on that cross and held him responsible for every sin in my life and then poured out his wrath on him? What does that mean? Man, I don't really know, but I can't imagine what it would have been like, because Jesus didn't do it for just me. He did it for all of you too. That's enough sin in this room to do a whole lot of pouring out of wrath on a cross. But we also stretch this out through the span of beginning of men to the last person to live on this earth. And all the sin accumulated was held on Jesus' account. And God poured out his wrath on Jesus as though he was personally responsible. I just can't wrap my mind around it. I really can't. What love is this that would hold a man to that cross to endure that? It's relational. God loves us. He'll endure whatever it takes to rescue us. This is eternal life. Verses 4 and 5, I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. I think in these words, we see very, very clearly the eternality and the pre-existence of Jesus Christ. Did you catch that? Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. Jesus did not exist, come into existence 2,000 years ago in Bethlehem. He existed long before that. In fact, if we were to read Colossians 1:16, it tells us that for by him all things were created in heaven and earth, visible, invisible, authorities and powers, principalities. All these things were created through him and for him. Jesus was around a long time before he was given that name as a little infant when he was born to be our Savior. So even as Jesus is pouring out his heart before the Father, he's reminiscing. Remember, God, what it was like before this world was even created, before I even got involved in all of that. We had a perfect love that we shared together and a perfect glory. And he says, now glorify me in my hour as it was before this world even existed. Just a very telling first few sentences of this prayer that teach us a lot about who Jesus is. So that's the first paragraph. The second paragraph, he now begins to talk about his disciples. This is what's said. Verse 6, I have manifest your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now, we've already talked about this thing about God choosing, but here I want you to hear how these men that followed Jesus were described. They have kept your word. That should be how we would be described as followers of Jesus Christ. Our love is demonstrated to God through our obedience. We must keep the word of God. This must be our testimony as well. Verses 7 and 8. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you, for I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know truth that I come from you, and they have believed that you sent me. You know, the same thing works for us today. We're talking about them receiving the truth and believing. It's the same ministry that we share in today, is taking the words and making it available for people to receive and to believe, and it's the journey that we continue to be on today. Verse 9 and 10, I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and all yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. It's interesting how Jesus limits the scope of his prayer right here. He's not praying for every individual on the earth. He is praying for followers of Jesus Christ. He is praying for those whom the Father has given him. Again, not everybody in the world is children of God. Sometimes you'll hear that said. Well, we're all God's children. No, we're not. No, we're not. John 1:12 says that it's as many as receive Jesus that are given the right to become children of God. Those who believe in his name, those are God's children. These are the people that that Jesus now is praying for. And what a sweet thing that he says in verse 10 as he's talking about them. I am glorified in them. Man, wouldn't that be an awesome testimony to have? If Jesus was testifying to the Father about our lives, how it was lived, and his statement was, Father, this person, this man, this woman glorified me with their life. Man, that is a win. You've done it right. That's what counts. More than anything else, we are to bring glory to Jesus with our lives. I mean, can you think of how, you know, there's few things that get me excited to the level when I think about God seeing me face to face and saying, well done, good and faithful servant. I mean, with all my heart, I can't even describe. That is my win in life if I get to hear those words. But to hear Jesus, if he was testifying of me before the Father and he said, God, this man has glorified me with his life. Wow. Can you imagine? But we have to live today. And tomorrow, we have to live each day to glorify him if that will be the testimony that Jesus gives to the Father. But Jesus prays this way, and oh, believers, it ought to motivate us. It ought to stir up a desire in us. I want to glorify Jesus with my life. And it causes us to look. Am I living in such a way now that if the rest of my life looks like the last week I just lived, is it going to take me there? In Jesus' mercy, he is allowing us to hear this and just saying, he's just reminding us, hey, examine yourself. Are you living in such a way that you are going to honor me with your life? This is truly our desire, Christians. We want to bring him glory. Verse 11, and I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world. And I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. In verse 11, he even praying for the disciples in his immediate presence begins to pray for their unity. He knows that tough times are coming. He knows they're going to be scattered. He knows they're going to be disheartened, scared. And he begins to pray for their unity. And we'll say more about this to come because he's going to pray that for us as well. Verse 12, while I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction. That would be Judas Iscariot, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Now, that comes right out of the heart of where we were last week as Jesus was speaking to his disciples about facing life's difficult trials and circumstances, maintaining the joy of the Lord through the most difficult and darkest of times, because the joy that we receive from God is not dependent upon circumstances. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on that today. If you weren't here last week, you can jump on our website and you can hear all about it from last week. We spent the whole time talking about the joy of the Lord. But again, now Jesus is praying over that. The instruction he gave his disciples last week that we talked about, now he is praying over that would be realized in their lives. All right, verse 15, prepare yourself. This is a downer. I do not ask that you take them out of the world. Come on, Jesus. I mean, that's not the way I would have prayed that part. He was doing really good here. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. Jesus prays for victory over the enemy. And he could not state it any plainer, more plain, that it's not the circumstances he's worried about. It's how you glorify him in those circumstances. God's plan is not to take all the Christians that they would never have to taste of the suffering of the world. As much as I would like that to be the case, that day is coming, by the way. But right now, we participate in the effects of the curse. We experience too the suffering. Jesus is very clear. We must participate in his suffering to share in his glory. And while we participate in the suffering, he gives us a joy that rises above what the circumstances would dictate. And that becomes the magnet of the world, where they raise their eyebrows and say, "What's up with you?" And Jesus says, "I want it that way." The world needs to see you suffer, Christians, and they need to see you suffer well. Don't take them out of the world, God. Just keep them from the evil one. Now, what Jesus does not want to see is the kingdom of darkness have its way with you, to strip you of the things that God has planned for you, to keep you under its thumb, to keep you from a life of righteousness and fulfillment, and an abundant life participating in the person and the mission of Christ. That's not the design. As we go through those things, we need to keep that connection healthy. They are not of this world, just as I am not of this world. Verse 17, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. By the way, this is the how, verse 17, to what he just said in 15 and 16. The way that we do this is we are sanctified, we are strengthened, we are matured in the truth, which is the word of God. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself that they also may be sanctified in truth. It's a big deal to Jesus that they be sanctified. Now, that's one of those big words we need to make sure we understand. When we talk about salvation, we're talking about our deliverance from the penalty and power of sin. And then the very next step now, it begins the process of sanctification. Sanctification starts the day that you're saved and ends the last time you exhale. It's the entire duration of your life. And it is used that each day you become a little bit more and a little bit more like Jesus Christ through our suffering, through our affliction, through the hardships, through the joys, through the journey. That we become more like Christ. That is sanctification, becoming more like Christ. And it's important we understand, 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says, this is God's will, that you are sanctified. If you're scratching your head saying, you know, I just never know what God's will is for my life, it's that you be more like Jesus. That's it. That's what you're supposed to be doing. Sanctification comes through the Word of God. Now here's where the second senior deacon comes in. Rich Fagley, he's a Sunday school teacher. In fact, he's teaching right now, I believe. If you talk to him for any length of time, you will soon find out that the passion of his heart is that God's children would be deeply studying and involved in searching the Scriptures. Now, he's in good company with that heart's desire. Paul the Apostle loved the Bereans because they eagerly received the word and checked daily to see if those things that they were being taught were in the word of God. They were lovers of God's word, and that impressed Paul. He even said, I like you guys better than the Jews in Thessalonica. because of the way you handle the word. We have to be those kind of Christians, church. Man, the church in America is floundering. God has set us up to be more like Christ. He has set us up that in a dark culture, we would be light. We would be salt. We would be the stake in the ground when it come to all these different things in our culture where morality is completely falling apart and injustice and righteousness. It is supposed to be the church and the people of God that says, no, we stand firm here. We are the light. But because we have become so weak in the word, we're not sure what's right and wrong. And when the pressure comes from the culture, so many churches have just set the book aside and said, well, we don't want to offend anybody. So they just join the current and celebrate the things that grieve God's heart. How awful when the church and the people of God begin to celebrate the things that grieve God's heart, the very things we've been delivered from. And church, it'll happen to Cornerstone too if we do not become and maintain being a people of the word. I cannot do it for you. I am so glad you're here this morning and that we get to go into a chapter of the Bible this morning. But there's not enough Sunday mornings in our lifetimes to seek out the depth of the scriptures. It has to become a journey for you. You have to daily get into the word of God, seeking God through this, understanding that you are sanctified through this, that God opens your eyes and works on your soul and tunes you up on a day-to-day basis as you seek the scriptures for yourself. And maybe you're thinking, well, preacher, I don't understand everything that I read. Neither do I, all right? Get in there, and once you do understand, run with it. It's a journey. You can't delegate this to a Sunday school teacher or a radio host or a pastor. It doesn't work that way. You need to search the scriptures for yourself. And through that, the Spirit of God sanctifies you. And if you skip over this state, if you skip over that step, you will be a very malnourished, weakened Christian, not ready for battle. None of us wants to be there. If you're too busy to get the word of God in your life on a daily basis, you are too busy. Cut something somewhere. Get this into your schedule and do it with a joyful heart. Don't approach it like, man, I really got to do this. I'm feeling guilty about not being in my Bible. No, you get to be with God. You get to open up your heart and allow the word to shape you and make you more like Jesus so that when this life is over, you have lived in such a way that Jesus can testify of your life. That servant brought me glory with their life. You are working toward a reward. This is motivational. This is exciting. God is giving us the opportunity. He has given us the tool in our hands that it will take to transform us on a day-by-day basis to be more like Christ. Sanctify them with your word. That's how Jesus prayed for us. Therefore, let's participate with that desire of his heart. Okay, now we're into the last section, and this is where Jesus prays for us. To me, this is the exciting part. It blows my mind that Jesus was able to pray for me today. Now, here, remember the key to the book of John. It's in John chapter 2. I've said this many times through this study. And it's in John chapter 2, 24 and 25. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was slain. Himself knew what was in man. So as we understand what Jesus, all through the scriptures, in each of these stories, he saw the woman at the well. He knew it was in her heart. He was able to minister. He picked out the disciples. He even said, I know it's in your heart. They were amazed. He went to the woman caught in adultery, knew it was in her heart, was able to speak and minister to her in an amazing way. He came up to the rich young ruler, knew it was in his heart, was able to challenge him right where he was at. Everywhere Jesus went, he encountered people, and he knew right what was in their heart, knew how to speak to them, and he just skipped over their questions and went right to the root issue. But Jesus, in his omniscience and in his sovereignty, That doesn't work just in people that were around him, encountering him in his day. As he enters into this high priestly prayer, he is able to look down through the test of time, and he is able to see followers down the line, generation after generation, thousands of years. He could see the needs of those people, and he began to pray for them because he knew it was in the hearts of men and women. And here's how he prays. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. That's us. He's praying for us right now. He's praying for me. Verse 21, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. Verse 21, Jesus is praying for our oneness, our unity. And why? So that the world believes that God has sent Jesus. It is the megaphone of the gospel. Verse 22, the glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Jesus continues to pray again for our unity. Listen to this, verse 23, I in them, you and me, that they may become perfectly one. You think unity is important to Jesus? He's kind of emphasizing it here. So that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Jesus repeatedly says over and over, I want them to be united. I want them to be one so that the world understands and sees me. Our unity is the megaphone of the gospel. And our disunity is the muting of the gospel. Verse 24, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Verse 25, O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. As Jesus is praying for us in this paragraph, he really hones in on the idea of our unity, our unity, our oneness, our unity of spirit, our unity of mind, our unity of mission, our unity in Christ. And we ought to be encouraged by the fact that we can see him praying to this end. Robert Murray McCain said it, he's an author, and he said this, if I could hear Christ praying in the other room, and he was praying for me by name, I would not fear a million enemies. Isn't that true? Isn't that great? Because I know he is praying for me. Yet distance makes no difference. Here's what he wants. Here's what this author is stating. If Jesus is in the other room, if one of us, if you came up here to pray at the end of a service and you just knelt up here at the stage and you were just spending some time with God, that's a good thing for us to do, church, as God begins to work in our hearts and we just take some time, just separate us from all the church activity, come before the altar, just one-on-one, God, you have my attention and I want to work through something with you. If you became aware that Jesus was around the hallway and he was praying for you by name, by need, over the very issue that brought you here, would you not become increasingly encouraged that, you know what, I'm going to have the victory in this? I mean, I can hear Jesus praying for me by name. And yet we're told in Hebrews 7:25, as Hebrews is teaching about Jesus being our high priest, says this, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him because he always lives to intercede for them. Jesus is praying for you. Distance makes no difference. Whether he's around that corner or he's up at the throne of God, understand Jesus is our high priest, just as he was praying in John 17, continues that ministry today. That's why the veil was torn when Christ died and rose again, because now he's our priest. And it is the role and function of a priest to pray for his people. And Jesus fulfills it perfectly. He prays for me and he prays for you. That ought to encourage you, Christian. So as we talk about unity here, The unity, our unity is essential to bring glory to God. We can't do it outside of that. You know, and I would say this is why it is so important, Christians, that we cannot carry offenses toward other Christians, period. As followers of Jesus, we cannot carry offenses toward one another. We can't hold that over one another. There's too much at stake. If our unity is the megaphone of the gospel and our unity is the means by which God is glorified, then as a follower of Christ, I no longer have the option to hold unforgiveness or bitterness of any sort in my heart. I can't do that. If I choose to do that, I am trading in my gospel influence and God's ability to glorify himself through my life. Not a good trade. Not for anyone. In fact, a Christian cannot do that. We cannot call ourselves children of God. We cannot call Jesus our Lord and King and hang on to things in our lives that would stop him from receiving glory in our life. It can't be done. Which is why Jesus prays to this end so strong on unity, unity of the church, unity of the believers that we're going to follow him. And this is a tough one. You know, I saw on social media, one of our church leaders posted this verse, Colossians 3:12, and it says, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves in compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. These are the things that bring about the unity of the body and the health of the body." Now, this may shock you, but not all Christians get along, all right? Just doesn't happen. But we must commit to unity in our own lives. We must commit to unify for God's glory and so that the gospel can be advanced. Yeah, I want to point you out. I'm going to close here with this, but here's something interesting for you to take. I like the Old Testament. I am a fan. I see such cool things happen in the Old Testament that bring things to life for me in a unique perspective. Genesis 11:6 paints this prayer in a unique perspective. The power of unity in an unlikely source. Genesis, I'm going to read this to you, chapter 11, verse 6. We're at the Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel. And all the wickedness in the world has united itself together for a single purpose against God. Listen to what God says. The Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they all have one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do, and nothing that they purpose to do will now be impossible for them." God saw unity in a dark place and said, "That is a threat that I have to address. I cannot let this go on." So listen to what God does. "Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of the earth, and they left off building the city." They stopped doing what they were doing. "Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth." God's plan was to destroy their unity when he came against darkness in a very unique Old Testament setting. Satan was not the first one to develop this battle strategy. And being this strategy is old as the Tower of Babel itself, this is why Satan tries to divide God's people. God, in essence, was saying, because these people are united, there is nothing that they cannot do. I have to put a stop to this. And when God's people come together united, the prince of darkness understands that there will be nothing that they are not capable of doing. There is no advancement of the kingdom that will be withheld. There is no area of darkness that will be safe from their influence. And Satan understands that unity is what must be attacked. Pray for unity at Cornerstone. I'll make you this promise. Unity is a powerful weapon against the enemy. So anywhere a church becomes united in heart, soul, mind, mission, and surrendered to the Lord and begins to advance the gospel in a way that starts making waves and the kingdom of darkness takes note, I can tell you what the battle strategy is. Disrupt the unity. Get them fighting amongst themselves, because just like God said when he looked at the Tower of Babel, if this continues on, there's nothing they won't be able to do. When a church unites filled with the Spirit of God and comes together around his purposes, the powers of darkness look at that and say, if we don't break this up, there is nothing that they will not be able to do. And it happened. It is the go-to battle plan of Satan. Disrupt the unity, disrupt the influence of the gospel, disrupt the ability for God to glorify himself through the people. So Jesus, as he gets on his knees in the Garden of Gethsemane, looking far into the future, seeing the struggles and the battles that are going to happen as his people try to advance God's kingdom, he prays for unity. Unity. And Cornerstone, I am comforted knowing that Jesus is praying now for our unity, for our strength. Let me finish with this final verse, verse 26. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Jesus finishes his prayer, as is recorded in John 17, with a note on love, the love of believers for one another. Well, that would bring us to our third senior deacon. If you know Gene Smith, you know there's a man who knows how to love. If you've ever been loved on by Gene Smith, he's an amazing man. And his love for other people is completely disarming. It's incredible. He loves the way that we're supposed to love, when filled with the Spirit. And I'm just going to close by reading, not preaching through, just reading 1 Corinthians 13, because it just speaks for itself so beautifully. If I speak in tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith, as so to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. It's powerful stuff. Love has to be the bedrock of this Christian community. If we fail in love, church, it will be our greatest of all failures. We cannot fail in any area any worse than if we fail in the area of love. God has loved us. Jesus now prays that we would love one another with the love that God has shown him. So as Jesus prays over this church, as you hear Jesus' heart being poured out on your behalf, I pray that you are encouraged. You've not been forgotten or forsaken. There is a plan in place, and God is praying for your victory, that you would not be overcome by the evil one. Let's pray, church. Father, once again, we delight in your word. Your truth excites us, it frees us, it empowers us. The journey ahead for Cornerstone is so real, Father. I am just stirred in my heart, because I believe that you have purposed great things for Cornerstone. And I know that we've gotten the attention of our enemy. So I pray, Father, that you would strengthen our hearts. And at the same time, that you would create within each of us here a sensitivity, that we would know when we're grieving your Spirit, that we would know that we are behaving or acting in such a way that we're not glorifying you, because I know it's the desire, Father, of every heart here today that we would bring you honor and glory with our lives. It is not our desire that we would be a bitter people, an unloving people, an unforgiving people, and yet all of us struggle with these things, Father. It's the nature of the battle. And yet you pray, Father, not that our circumstances would change, but you pray that Satan would not find victory in this place. So, Father, we pray in agreement with our King that you would take us through the fire and that we would walk out in victory, that you would receive the glory, and that we would be changed forever. Keep us in step with your Spirit, Lord. May Cornerstone Church and the people that make her up experience everything that you have intended for us to accomplish. Cornerstone, as you're praying right now for the Spirit to seek you, to search you, to see if there's any wicked way, cooperate with him. This is difficult territory. There's stuff that happens in families and between wives and husbands and church ministries and all around. This is at the heart of the spiritual battle, and we have to address these things in our own life with the Lord. So in his love, let him come alongside you and take you through that journey that you can walk out in victory. And as you're doing this, as I always do each Sunday, I want to make the opportunity for our friends. You've heard much here about how God chooses his people. How God wants the people in this world to become a part of his family. How our sin has caused him to be angry. We have offended him, and yet he has offered a solution that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord can become a part of this journey, can join his family, can be forgiven. The Bible says that God draws us when that time is coming near, when we are ready to receive him. Right now, if you sense that God is drawing you to take a step of faith and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that your sins would be forgiven, this is your opportunity to acknowledge that work that is happening in your heart and to embrace God's invitation. With no one looking around, if God is taking you on that journey, if you sense that he is drawing you, and you don't even know what all that means, but you just sense that God is prodding you to take a step of faith into his family, to begin this journey, with no one looking around, would you just put your hand up in the air for me to see? Just you acknowledging before God, I'm not going to point you out or embarrass you. It takes courage to put your hand up. Thank you, sir. Who else here this morning would just acknowledge, man, I just feel you starting to draw me, God, and it's kind of a scary thing, but I don't want to resist you. I want to cooperate with you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Who else here this morning would join these people? Thank you, sir. Thank you. Who else? If that's where your heart is this morning, and you can put your hands down, I can't express to you how much God loves you. And your sin has wounded him. But he has carved out a plan to rescue you from that, the effects of that sin and his wrath. Jesus took your penalty and now invites you to join him, to follow him, to surrender and submit to him alone, to give away your life, that the sole purpose of each day from this day to the day that you die would be to live for him and to bring him glory until the day that you see him face to face. God longs to take you on that journey. If you are ready to embrace him and take that journey, God listens to the cry of your heart. The gospel says that we must ask God to forgive us of our sin and that we must place our faith completely and wholly in Jesus Christ alone for our eternal life. If you are ready to make that commitment this morning, I would invite you right now, in this time before God, as you sense Him drawing you, this is how you say yes. Just pray a prayer like this. Talk to God like this. God, right now, from my heart, I want to embrace this call on my life. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and that I have sinned against you, that I have grieved you, and I ask you to forgive me of that sin in my life. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, I ask you to wash it all away, to cleanse me, that I can come into a right relationship with you. I ask you to forgive me. And in this moment, I place my faith in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I believe He died, He was buried, and He rose again, just like the Scriptures say. And in this moment, I place all my faith and trust in Him alone. From this day forward, God, I'll live for you. Thank you for saving me. With no one looking around, if you just prayed that prayer from your heart to God, again, I won't point you out or embarrass you, but would you just place your hand up as an acknowledgement to the Lord? I just made that commitment.